Okay, I think we're ready to start. So, hello everybody, thank you for coming. I'll begin the presentation with a question. What do all these objects have in common? A desktop computer, a phone, tablet, watch, glasses, a car, television, a house? Well, for starters, we now put the word smart in front of all these objects. We have smartphones, smart televisions, smart cars, etc. You may remember from the keynote, a concept called the Internet of Things was mentioned. It is trying to bring everyday objects and connect them to the Internet. All these objects would have an operating system and a way to access the Internet. But more importantly, all these objects would have one technology in common. All of them would be able to execute web technologies, or in other words, HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. So the answer to the question from the previous slide is, all these objects would be able to execute the exact same web application written with these three technologies. It could be, for example, a clock widget, a notification app, weather conditions, instant messaging, the list goes on. Imagine, for example, starting a chat with a friend on your computer at home, then continuing it while you walk on your phone, and finishing up in your car while driving through voice commands. That's possible nowadays with web technologies. So hopefully by now I have grabbed your attention, so it's time to introduce myself. My name is Peter Manev, and I'm a senior QA at Order Dynamics. I'm also the lead QA on a project called Dynamic Action, which, as you may have guessed, is a single-page web application. And I've been working on this project for about a couple of years ago, since its very beginning. Outside of work, I like to travel, and I'm a keen photographer, two hobbies that really go hand by hand. But enough about me, let's see what you can expect in the next 30 or so minutes. First of all, we're going to see what are single-page applications and why they could be interesting to us. We're going to see how they differ from the traditional websites that we're all very familiar with, and we're going to see how to test them, both functionally and non-functionally, like performance, security, layout, and a few other things. And since this is an automation-focused conference, we're going to see how to automate the whole testing process. And at the end, of course, a few minutes for questions. So let's begin then. What are SPAs and why should we care about them? Unfortunately, it's not what you see in the picture. Single-page web applications are web applications that consist of just a single but very dynamic and volatile HTML web page. The content on it changes dynamically, independently, and very often driven by JavaScript. We must note the term applications here. We're not talking about simple websites anymore. The user experience of web applications is very similar to the user experience brought by traditional desktop applications. The page never reloads. It's very important. The user experience is, from this fact, becomes very fluent, very interactive, very involved. It's not paginated anymore like with traditional websites. Single-page web applications have also one big benefit. As you saw, they can run on many different devices. You just have to load them in your browser. So why should you care about single-page web applications? It's because of their increasing popularity. The world of today relies heavily on communication. Everybody wants to be able to access both their applications and their data everywhere, whether it's at home, in the office, or on the go. The amount of traditional desktop applications is decreasing very fast. If you think about it, almost any application that you use on your computer or on your device, it has a web version that you could use. It could be your web client you access from your browser. With the latest version of Microsoft Office, all the applications are available as web applications in your browser. You can chat with your friends from the browser. You listen to music in your browser with web applications. You watch videos. You play games in the browser. If you think about it, doing web development, the browser is probably the best environment to do it. The proof that you could only use web applications and none of the traditional desktop applications is Mozilla's operating system, Firefox OS. Its UI is built entirely with web technologies. Every single thing that the user sees and interacts in on their screen is built with HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. So in the future, there is a good chance that you have to deal with single-page web applications, and this presentation would be useful to you. Right, let's see how SPAs differ from the traditional websites. I'm sure you're all very familiar with this diagram, so I'll just go quickly through it. We've got everybody's favorite Internet Explorer here, requesting a page from the server. The server gets some data from the database, generates HTML dynamically on the fly, and returns the page to the browser, which then renders the page. It's an oversimplified diagram. We're not considering a few things like requests for resources or caching, but they're not that interested to us at the moment. Now let's see for the SPA architecture. We've got the browser again requesting the application from the server. This time, instead of the server dynamically generating HTML or getting data from the database, most often it straight away returns HTML, CSS, and JavaScript to the browser. This JavaScript contains the whole business logic of the application. The JavaScript then changes the HTML dynamically, and it looks completely different from what the server initially sent us. At this point, if the application needs some data from the server, it again requests it with an AJAX call, the server gets some data and returns it to the application. You must note that most probably we're using some data-like format like JSON. The server is not generating any HTML, it's not returning any markup, so it's probably even smaller. This architecture has a lot of benefits. First of all, it's very interactive. It's faster to load after the initial load of the application, of course. The server is not generating any HTML, so the server is also faster. It's also more economical. The amount of data transferred is smaller because it's just data format. That could be a huge benefit if you're, for example, on a 3G network. This architecture is known as a thick client, and all the heavy lifting is distributed to your users. Their machines are executing all the application logic. So we not need expensive servers in order to support more users. There's also no install. You just fire up your browser, and you load the application. Updates are usually very easy to do, very easy to distribute to your users. Of course, if you need to run the application offline, you'd need to install it. And probably the biggest benefit of single-page applications is that you can build them once and run them on any device. Okay, now we know what are single-page applications. Let's see how we can test them. First of all, manual testing on SPA is not that different from manual testing a traditional website. You just fire up your browser, open the browser console, and you start clicking everywhere on the page, right? Statistically speaking, sooner or later, you'd hit a bug. Well, hopefully, you're not doing it like that, and you have a somewhat well-defined test plan, test cases, and you need to execute them very often, perhaps every day or every few weeks. So I'm sure you all know the answer to the question, what do you do here? You start automating. So first order of business, choosing the right tool for your automation. Let's look at what are single-page web applications. After all, they are web applications, so they consist of HTML and the DOM of the browser. So our tool would need to be able to interact with this. It will need to be able to find elements on the page, click them, type into input fields, and maybe have an API to the browser itself. There are a lot of tools out there that can do that, but probably the most popular one, and also open source, is Selenium WebDriver. So we're going to use it as a reference for the rest of this talk. Now, let's look at some specifics about single-page application automation with Selenium. Single-page web apps, as we said, they're very dynamic. They change very often. DOM of the browser is very dynamic. And the way Selenium and other tools handle this is through the use of dynamic weights, or also known as fluent weights. Or in other words, statements in your code that say, wait 30 seconds for that element to appear, and if it doesn't, time out and throw an exception. With single page web applications, we'll need a lot of these waits, hundreds, maybe even thousands of them, because a lot of the elements change. Imagine having this application. Notice that it has 10 different components. All of them load asynchronously from each other. You don't know which one will be loaded first. You don't know which one will be loaded last. Using dynamic weights, you need to add 10 different statements just for this page of the application. Now, dynamic weights bring a lot of problems. First of all, they blow up your code. It becomes very big. These statements are not necessary to read. They make the code harder to write, read, and maintain. Moreover, they slow up your tests. If you have thousands of dynamic weights executed, and each one slows down with just several hundred milliseconds your tests, at the end, it will be minutes when they pile up. But probably the biggest issue with fluent weights is that they make your tests fragile, or in other words, they introduce random failures. In our application, there are days when we run about 10,000 tests, automated tests, and even if we have the slightest chance of a random failure, this means that we would have to investigate a lot of random failure issues, and they're just a nightmare to debug, to reproduce even. You don't want to do that, you want to avoid it at all costs. So, what we can do to improve this process? First, let's look at the problem, the cause of the problem. It's because the tests are not synchronized with the application. The tests execute some action, and they start making assumptions about the state of the application or when the needed element would appear. So every second, for example, they go and they ask the DOM of the browser, is that element there? Is that element there? Is that element there? Until it appears or the test times out. A much better approach would be if we could synchronize the tests with the application. Or in other words, each and every test step, action or validation in our tests need to be executed at the right time, when the application has finished processing everything and has nothing to do. Let's see at a diagram that could explain this more easily. We've got our test code with just a couple of actions, mouse click on a button, and a validation step. The first action is sent to the test runner, which could be Selenium, for example. The test runner would then go and ask the application, I want to execute some action, so tell me when you're idle. Notice that we're asking the application, not the DOM of the browser, because the DOM of the browser does not know what actions still need to be processed. In this case, the application is in ready state, so straight away it returns, OK, I'm ready, you can execute the action. The test runner executes the action, the application starts loading something. At this point, the second part of the test code is sent to the test runner, which again asks the application, I want to execute another action, tell me when you have finished processing everything. At the point where the application is ready, everything is loaded, it returns to the test runner, I'm ready, which then executes the validation. If at this point the application has said that it's ready, but our test validation test step does not find the element needed, we know that we should fail because the element would not appear. The application has nothing more to process. This is much faster, there are no waits, and it is much more stable. Let's look a little bit deeper at the implementation part. It consists of two things. First of all, the application needs to be able to keep track what actions remain to be executed, or in other words, it needs to have a queue of actions. And the second thing is your tests need to be able to synchronize with your application. Or in other words, you need to instrument your test code in order, before each step, to synchronize with your application. Now, this approach is not new. It was implemented first by the AngularJS framework. It's probably the most popular single-page application framework out there. And this framework supports keeping track of its state. It knows all the actions it has to process, and it can register a callback when there is nothing more to do. The AngularJS team also built a tool that can do the second part, or the instrumentation. It's called Protractor. Now, they went smart about it. They did not build the tool from scratch. They built it as a wrapper around Selenium WebDriver, which is really great because they use Selenium to do all the heavy lifting, like finding elements on the page, interacting with the browser, etc. And they're just instrumenting all the tests so that you do not have to write any wait statements. You just write your test in a synchronous manner. Now, we've been using this approach for a couple of years now. We have hundreds of tests written. They're executed thousands of times every day. And it's working really great for us. We have seen very, very few random failures, actually so few that you can count them on your fingers. And every time we have seen a random failure, it was either because of an issue with a third party that we're using, or because some of our code was implemented against the best practices when building single-page web applications. And all of them were very easy to work around and to fix. I highly recommend, if you're doing automation for single-page web applications, that you use this approach. Now, you might not be using AngularJS, you might be using some other framework. So let's see what you can do in this case. First of all, let's see at what we need in order to synchronize, in order to keep track of our application. With web applications, there are a couple of things we need to synchronize with. First of all, that's AJAX requests. And second, that's asynchronous sections, like set timeouts, web workers, or animations. If you're using a framework to develop your single-page applications, and you're most probably using a framework to do it, your framework probably already has a way to keep track of all these sections, because it's a very common task that you need to execute. For example, some method on all the incoming or all the outgoing requests from your application. So your framework most probably already has a way of keeping track of these things. What you have to do is write a very simple function that can register a callback method when there are no more requests or no more asynchronous actions to happen. It's really simple to do, just a few lines of JavaScript. There's a catch here. Something that you should not synchronize with, and that's recurring events. For example, we have a clock widget on your application, and every second it updates to show the right time. If you try to synchronize with this event, you'll never be able to, because it's in a constant loop, and you need to be very careful about this. The second part, instrumentation of your code, you could use Protractor. It is very well built, and the part that's synchronized with your application, it's abstracted with just a couple of lines of JavaScript that you could very easily replace with your own synchronization function. Okay, with just these two simple steps, we'll be able to completely functionally test our application. Let's see about non-functional tests, and let's start with performance testing. If we're speaking about like load testing or measuring how many concurrent users your application can handle, all the traditional tools like JMeter, LoadUI, or LoadRunner, they work pretty well here. They support very well single-page web applications. So it's not that interesting to us. Let's see about UI performance. Single-page web applications, they're usually very heavy. And if they're not well written, the browser could struggle and spend a few seconds to process the application logic and render everything in the browser. We obviously need to execute this kind of testing very often, perhaps on each change set. So we'll need to automate it. Let's see it, what we do for traditional websites. We usually use a tool that can crawl your whole website, take every single page, and then execute UI performance measuring tool like WiseWall or PageSpeed. The problem with these tools is that they give us just the initial loading time of our page or our application. And with single page web applications, we're interested in the other 99% of the time. It's not a bad idea to run these tools to get an idea of your initial loading time, but it's not what we're looking for. So let's see what we need. There's no tool that can run for us outside of the box. First of all, we need to go through all the pages, sub-pages of our application, or all the states, as they're called in single-page applications. And we need to measure how long does each action take. For example, you click on a button, something loads, and you need to measure the time from the click of the button until everything is loaded. So first of all, the crawling problem. How do we find all the actions in our application and execute them? And after each action, we need to synchronize with our application so that we know it's ready. There is nothing more to process, a concept familiar from the functional tests. Now, crawling a single page web application is no easy task. Actually, it's pretty hard. Actually, it's so hard that at the moment, there is no tool that can outside of the box do this for you for different applications. Just to give you an idea of how hard it is, imagine having to write a tool that can crawl and find all the actions in the web version of Microsoft Office, like slides, documents, Excel spreadsheets. It's not an easy task. There's a lot of effort going on in this area, but nothing ready at the moment. So there's no tool that can do this for us. Arriving at this situation, here's what we did. We thought, well, we already have hundreds of functional tests written. They're pretty much aware of our application logic. They can navigate most of it. So why not use our functional tests to create a performance testing framework? And that's what we did. We extracted some methods from our functional tests, and we created the Navigator class. Its purpose is to take your automated tests and take your application to the desired state that you want. You just call a method navigate to, you pass the desired state, and the class takes your application to that desired state. We went ahead and we added one more thing here. We added a method that allows you to pass an array of states in a method. So the navigator class would go through each and every one of these states and to execute the method that you wanted to. This approach has a lot of benefits. First of all, it's really easy to maintain. Everything is one place. We had most of the code already. We have synchronization with the application because our functional tests are already synchronized. So just like that, in less than a day of work, we were able to get the first results for performance testing of our application. Let's see another thing that we could do. If we measure the whole time it takes to load a particular action, we don't know where time is spent. Is it that the server took a lot of time to load the data, or is it that our application logic took a lot of time to process and to render everything in the browser? Now, we investigated three different approaches what we could do here. First of all is code instrumentation, or in other words, instrument your code so that you could get some data from it. You saw that from the previous lecture. Angel described it in a very good detail, so I'm not going to talk much about this approach here. Second one is using a proxy server to get all your network requests happening. If you get all the network requests and you know the total time, you could subtract that and get the time the UI took to load. This approach has the biggest benefit that it will work with any browser, any device. But it also has a lot of issues with it. First of all, you have to set it up both in your testing environment and your local environment. You have to start it up, stop it up. And generally, it's a third party that you have to maintain, and it brings a single point of failure for your tests. So we investigated the third approach. It's the resource timing API of the browser. It's a JavaScript API that allows you to get information about the network request that happened on your application. It's something like a JavaScript API to the network tab on your console. It's very simple to use, just one line of JavaScript. There's no maintenance of it. The issue with it is that not all browsers support it. Firefox implemented support for it with the latest release, while Internet Explorer, while Safari still does not support it. Internet Explorer and Chrome do support it. So at the end, we went with a hybrid approach between the first and the third option here, which is working very well for us. Now, let's see what else we could get from these performance tests. A request count. Imagine clicking on a button and your application goes and performs 20 requests to the server. 20 requests is probably too much. Well, that would depend on the type of your application, but it's an indicator that you're not doing something very well and you could optimize. So we could measure the request count on each action and raise issue flags if they're too much. Second, unnecessary or duplicate requests. You'll be surprised how many times we've seen duplicate requests happening for the same action that could be optimized so that both the server and the UI would run faster. As with every performance test, there are a few things that you need to consider. With traditional websites, you need to consider server-side caching. But with single-page applications, you also need to consider UI caching. If you do some action on your application and you perform it a second time, the application could cache all the data and not make a second request to the server. So it would be a good idea maybe to run a warm-up round on your application. Second thing is animations. Depending on the type of the animation, you might want to check how long does it take, or you might not want to do it. Depends on your application, so you might want to disable some of the animations when doing these types of tests. Now, when speaking about performance testing, usually resource leaks tests also come to mind. When you hear memory leak, probably you think about Java or .NET or C++, and probably the last thing you think about is JavaScript. That's because traditional websites usually do not care much about resource leaks. Even if your page has huge memory leaks, your user will very soon go to another page and all the resources will be freed, all the memory leaks would go away. That's not the case with single-page web applications. As we said, they're never reloaded, so that they could remain open for hours, maybe even days. And if you have memory leaks in your application, it could become very bad, we'll see in a moment. Memory is not the only thing that can leak here. CPU could also leak. Single-page applications, they usually consist of a lot of different components that talk to each other through events, and they add event listeners. If these event listeners are not cleared properly, they will just pile up and start using a lot of the CPU. And web applications usually run on just a single CPU core. So clearly, we need some kind of automated test that is executed very often. What we did in our case is we added an endurance test for the UI. How we did it? We used the Navigator class, and we passed it different arrays of methods, or effectively user journeys, simulating different user behavior in just a single browser. And this is repeated for a few hours. So we were simulating a real user using our application for a few hours, and during this time we monitor the CPU and the memory of the browser process. If there are any significant increases, it's an indicator for a leak in our application that needs to be fixed. Now, I cannot stress how important it is to perform these types of tests. So I'll show it with an image. Remember, we talked that web applications can run on many different devices. So imagine having a leak in an application that runs in your car and it runs out of memory. It could be very bad for you. We have seen times where the browser crashes because of memory leaks in our application. It's pretty bad. So, next topic, layout testing. Web applications can run on many different devices, which is great. But this could also bring nightmare for QAs, because you have to test your application in a lot of different devices. What problems could bring layout? We could for example, have overlapping components, unreadable text, unclickable buttons. So it's in this area there are some very big issues. How is layout testing traditionally done for normal websites? They're usually crawled by a crawler, which takes a screenshot on every page, and then compares the screenshot to a non-good state so that it could highlight all the differences. It's a very common approach. The Google Chrome team uses this approach when testing the Chrome browser. So how do we do it for single page web applications? It's very easy. We already have the Navigator class. We can go to all the states of our application. We could use the Selenium API to take screenshots of the browser. And there are a lot of tools out there that can do screenshot comparison for you. How do we test, how do we simulate different devices? Web applications, they differ on different devices based on the resolution of the device. It's very easy to change the resolution of your browser with JavaScript. It's just one line so that you could run these types of tests with a lot of different setups simulating different devices. What issues you could have with these types of tests? First of all, animations. It's a good idea to disable them because your screenshot could be taken at a little bit different time of the animation. It would break everything. And second bad thing is that if you're running these tests on different operating systems, they will render the font of the browser a little bit differently. Most often it's not visible by human eye, but an automated test comparison a pixel by pixel would capture this. So it's a good idea to put some tolerance value. For example, say if 99% are the same, then say it's okay. And probably the biggest issue with this approach is that it needs manual verification of the differences. Somebody has to manually go and say, yes, this is an expected change, or no, this is a bug in the application that needs to be fixed. Okay, let's see about security. Single page applications, they're sent to the users. So if you have some vulnerable code, the malicious user could see that in your application because they know all the code of your application. It's a good idea to obfuscate and minify your code so that malicious user would not be able to that easily read your application. Next, if you have some private code that should not be distributed to everyone, it's a good idea to extract it and put it in a different file that could be sent just to the authorized users. That could be, for example, administration code. If not, it could show some vulnerabilities in your API, for example, that a malicious user could use to attack. Third tool that could capture some security issues, it's static code analysis. It's always a good idea to run static code analysis, and it should be done during your build, as with the previous two steps. This is the right place to do it. What about going a little bit deeper? With traditional websites, there are a lot of tools out there that can perform successful security testing, like Zattack Proxy, Burp, or Nessus. There are a lot out there. The way they do it, they usually crawl your application and they perform different security attacks on each page of your website. But with single page web applications, they will not be able to crawl your application. So the way we do it, we use, again, the Navigator class. It can very well crawl our application, and we set up the security testing tool, listening as a proxy for all the requests. It captures all the requests, and after that, it can perform its security attacks on all the different routes of our application. Now, this approach is not perfect. It will not capture a lot of security issues, most related to cross-site scripting. So the way we're handling this is that we're adding these types of security tests in our functional test suite. It's not perfect, but it works very well for us. Let's see what other uses of the Navigator we could find. First of all, search engine optimization. Indexing bots will not be able to crawl your application, and they will not be able to index it. The way all the search engines handle this is that they ask you to support a couple versions of your application. One, JavaScript heavy, that is sent to all your users, and one HTML only, no JavaScript, that's sent to the indexing bot, which they could very easily crawl and index. The downside of this approach is that you have to support a couple of versions of your application, one for the users and one for the indexing bots. And with every new release, every new version, you need to create both versions. So it's a good place to automate. How do we do it? You use, again, the Navigator class to go to all the states of your application. And at each state, it takes all the HTML, saves it as a file on your hard drive, then generates a sitemap, and everything is sent to the search indexing bot. Other free things like analytics, internationalization, or HTTPS mixed content, we do something very similar. We use the Navigator class to go through each state of the application and perform a common verification on each state of our application. For example, just let's look at analytics. We perform some action like clicking on a button, and you want to see if Google Analytics event was sent by your application. We already know how to do it, how to capture network traffic. So it's very easy to do. Generally, the Navigator is a very good use for all common actions that you need to do on your application. Last thing we're going to talk about today is error reporting. If an error were to happen in your application, it will happen on your user's machine. And it's always a good idea to be notified of what errors are happening in your application. The way JavaScript handles this is you can register a method on window on error, and this method will be called every time an exception in your JavaScript happens, so you could get all the data and send it through AJAX to you. There are a lot of services that provide this outside of the box. You just have to include one JavaScript file in your application. It's very easy to do, and it will show you a lot of errors that your users are seeing that you most probably were not notified of. So if you remember three things about testing single-page web applications, they should be. First, synchronization is very important. If your tests are synchronized with your application, it will save you a lot of headaches, a lot of trouble along the way, and also a lot of time. I have spent hours, even days, trying to debug some random failures, and some of the times I was not able to. Second, navigation is crucial. Being able to crawl your application and go to each state is very important. You saw in just how many places we're using the Navigator class. And last thing, be very careful when selecting your tools and do not be afraid to create in-house solutions. Unfortunately, the testing tools have not quite get to the state of the developing tools for single-page web applications. So sometimes we need to be creative and to implement something ourselves. So hopefully you now should have a general idea of how to approach testing applications that can run on all these types of devices. So that was it for me. Thank you for listening and questions.
Okay, I have one simple question. So you said that you're doing visual test automation and you have some tolerance rate around 99%. But how do you do this and what kind of tools? Because sometimes the application might be in a different state and it will be difficult to get the same picture, for example.
Okay, so the tool that we're using, it actually supports passing a tolerance value. So the tool can automatically calculate how different or how similar the two images are, and it can give you a percentage. So when the tool gives us the percentage, it's very easy to us to see if this percentage is above the tolerance value or not. So it's just the tool.
I have a question. Are you aware of a tool called Siculi? Did you try it? Is there drawbacks?
Yeah. I'm pretty much aware of the tool. Actually, I have used it in a previous project that I worked on. We had about, 100 tests automated with Siculi. And it was not that good for me. The user experience that I get from this tool is that it had a lot of random failures, a lot of flaky tests. And generally, the tool did not work for me. Okay, if there are no more questions or somebody is shy, you could always find me afterwards. I'll be hanging around the Order Dynamics booth. Thank you again.